Okay, students, I'm back. Any questions?
Sir, are we also estimating this slope coefficient and the intercept also?
Yes. We are estimating beta 0 and beta 1, no?
Okay, sir. And the stochastic error too.
Stochastic error term will be estimated, yes. But you know, there are certain assumptions on that. Okay, I think it will become clear as I'm discussing. Okay, so let me, after the discussion, when I ask next time, if you still have doubt, you can ask me. Okay,
okay.
So now I will share my PPT. Present now on screen. Yeah, you can see my PPT, right? So all of
no,
you can
sir.
See you know, but it is telling it is visible. I will try again.
Yes sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay, fine. So what we discussed today is, okay, now let me change my notation. Until now I was using Ci as the dependent variable and Yi as explanatory variable for this specific example of a consumption function. Okay, there can be a demand equation where your left hand side variable can be Q, your right hand side variable can be P. Henceforth, we'll be specifying an econometric model in the form of, say, Yi is equal to, say, beta 0 plus beta 1 xi plus ui. Okay, so this is a general form simple regression model which we'll be discussing in general. Okay, here my dependent variable is yi, my explanatory variable is xi, and other things you know. This is a general simple regression model. From this, depending on the example, if we are discussing about consumption function, my yi will become ci, my xi will become yi. If it is a demand equation, my yi will become maybe qi and my xi will become pi. Okay, those are specific examples. In general, this is the simple regression model notation for our entire econometrics class. Let me put it as equation one now. You remember this as equation one. So whenever in the future I'll refer to equation number one, you refer to this one, which is a simple regression model. So as I said, we know value of yi, we know value of xi, and about ui, which oscillation was asking, I'll come that later. Now, if I estimate beta zero, beta one, this is we call estimation of the model. Of course, yes, there are certain additional things also we'll be estimating along with beta 0, beta 1. We'll be estimating about standard error, we'll be estimating covariance, you know, those things will come later. Okay, in estimation, this is the first part. And for each one of you, it is essential to understand the fundamentals of all these estimations. Okay. So let me have this example, which I was telling little earlier. And instead of 10 individuals, let me assume 5 individuals. It will be easier to show in the graph. So this point, oh no. So this point is the individual one. Why it is not? There may be here individual two. Is going. This individual is 2. Somewhere, say here, individual 3. Somewhere here, maybe individual 4. Maybe here, individual 5. So I have 5 individuals and their combinations of yi. Yi now I'm putting as a dependent variable and xi I'm putting as independent variable. Okay, Now, as I said, there are many lines possible which one can fit here. One line may be this one. Let me say this is line one. And for line one, if I fit line one, then this estimates yi estimated value is equal to say beta 0 1 plus beta 1 1 xi. Why ui is not appearing here? I'll discuss it later. Little later, I'll discuss. Just hold on. Huh? This is beta 0 1, beta 1 1. There could be, say, another line here, which is here line 2. And let me give value of yi hat, okay, based on beta 0 2 plus beta 1 2 xi. This is a different line, right? These are different lines because their intercepts and slope coefficients are different. I think this point will not be difficult for you to understand. What is important is how to know whether line 1 is better or line 2 is better. That is, beta 0, 1, beta 1, 1 are better, or beta 0, 2, beta 1, 2 pair is better to explain the pattern of relation between yi and xi. Okay, so how to know that? There is one possibility, one possible way of doing is we can find the deviation of each point from the fitted line or the estimated line. And for the line for which these deviations are less, then that line is better. Say, for example, here, I will use another ring. So I'll keep it. I'll go to another ring. Say, maybe blue. So let me draw the blue lines, which basically depict the deviation of actual value. Oh, it is still doing red. What happened? Okay, I can draw here, then I'll open it up. Okay, so this is the deviation from point one and line one. I can make it a little bigger. Oh no, okay, I don't want to play with this. Okay, so there could be the difference with deviation from point two to this line one is given in this blue line. 0.3, this blue line, and 0.4, this blue line, 0.5, this blue line. Okay. Now let me denote the difference deviation of the points from line 2 as this. There are some overlappings, huh? Okay, this has to be inside. Okay, so now see this. One way of judging, selecting which line better explains is we can basically find the deviation between actual values of yi, okay, from the estimated value of yi by a particular line. See this point, you know, this, I hope you understand. Say this point, let me take this point A. Point A measures what? Point A measures estimated value of yi for given value of x1, estimated value of y1 for given value of x1 by line 1, isn't it? So basically point A gives me y1 hat, okay? estimated by the line one, isn't it? This estimating that yi value is this much. Okay, and if here is point B, point B gives me what? B gives me y1 hat by line 2. The subscript is for individual and the superscript is for line. Okay, superscript 1 here for first line, superscript 2 here for the second line. Okay, so this way point A is the estimated value of y1 for given value of x1 by the line 1. Line 1 means when I'm choosing beta 0 1, beta 1 1. Point B is the estimated value of y1 for given value of x1 when I'm choosing line 2. So the deviation between this estimated value and actual value, so actual value minus y1 hat 1, this gives me deviation in actual and estimated values of y1 when line 1 is fitted. So let me put it as d1 1. Okay, and y1 minus y1 hat 2, this gives what? This gives deviation of actual values of y1 from the fitted value when line 2 is chosen. Okay, so which one is bigger? If you see, it looks that d1 is bigger than D1 1 is bigger than D1 2. So this is this blue line. No, this is nothing but D1 1. And this yellow line is nothing but D1 2. So in this graph, it appears D1 1 is bigger than D1 2. So if I go by deviation or error, this error is referring to the variation between the actual value and the estimated value. If I go by the deviation of y1 from the fitted value, it appears line 2 is better, isn't it? Why I'm telling line 2 is better? Because I'm thinking this yellow line is smaller than the blue line. So error is lesser if I confine to the estimated value of y1. Okay. Then the error is lesser if I'm choosing line 2 compared to line 1. Now come to point number 2. So if I am choosing point number 2 here, this is actual. Deviation is this yellow line, and yellow line when we are fitting line 2. Deviation is blue line when I'm referring to line 1. So which one is bigger here? Here, yellow one is bigger, right? Yellow is quite big compared to blue, as you can see. So when I'm talking about D2, D21 is less than D22. Okay. In case of 4, in case of flow 4, you can see D41 is greater than D42. All of you clear? These deviations I'm measuring as vertical distance between the point and the fitted line. Why I'm choosing vertical distance? Because y values are given in the y-axis. Okay. If I'll choose horizontal distance, that will measure x values. I'm not interested in x values. X values are given. We are trying to assess what will happen to y when change in x. So we are interested in y values. We are interested in dependent variable. Like for the consumption expenditure example, we are interested what will happen to consumption. We are trying to explain consumption behavior using x as one of the explanatory variables. That's why I'm choosing vertical distance, vertical deviation. Okay. So as you can see here, for some points, line one's deviation is lesser. For some points, deviation from line two is lesser. Okay. So one criteria could be, we'll add deviation one, deviation two, deviation three, deviation five for line one. Similarly, we'll add deviation 1, deviation 2, deviation 3 for line 2. And whichever is minimum, that may appear to be a better line explaining the pattern of relationship between the dependent variable and explanatory variable. Agree? So we'll calculate D11, we'll calculate D11, D21, D23 up to D51. Oh, I'm committing mistake. No. See, the subscript referred to individual, superscript referred to the line. So I'll calculate deviation of actual points from the fitted value when we are choosing line 1. And those deviation will be D11 plus D21 plus D31 plus D41 plus D51. Okay. So this is basically summation di1i running from 1 to 5. Similarly, I can calculate for line 2 and add those deviations. This will be di2 summation I from 1 to 5. So this summation is lower or this summation is lower. Whichever lower, that will represent that the sum of deviations are lower for line 1 or line 2. Accordingly, I choose which line is better. Assume this first one, that is summation di1 is lesser than summation di2. Then this will imply line 1 is better than line 2. This is one way. But is it the best way, or there is a way of improving this? All of you already have done this in statistics. Let me hear from you. Is this the best way, or there is better way of finding the better line? Yes, who will respond? Why all of you are silent?
Sir, we should take the summation of the squared value of the deviation.
Why? What is the advantage with that?
Sir, if we take the summation of the squared value, then it will perfectly show that how much distance is between the baseline and the error.
So how it is perfect, ma? Why this is not perfect? See, when you say as a student of econometrics, you have to be precise. Okay, don't use general words. So by perfect, what do you mean by perfect?
Sir, actually, when you are showing it in a graph, the distance between two lines is shown in squared form. So
by showing squared way, what advantage you have? See, when I say one is better, you need to explain why it is better, right?
Yes, sir.
What is why it is better?
Sir, actually, I'm having some problem in explaining. Sir, I know the answer, but
I understand. You know, many of you know this. But when you speak, actually, you know, that brings your clarity. Okay. Yes. What happens here? You know, I understand it, but if I am not able to explain, unless I am not able to explain, then, you know, my intuition is not clear. Okay. Any other student will try to help her?
Sir, because it's positive. Squared
true.
Value should be positive.
True.
So sometimes when the sum of the deviations may be negative, but the absolute value will be greater.
See, that is the thing I'm finding. You understand. Is it Akhilesh? Who is answering now?
Sir, Johan.
Johan, okay. Yeah, Johan. So maybe, you know, you understand it, but you are not able to put it in the words. You know, I want to know why that is better.
Sir, I'm Devika.
Devika, tell me.
I'm not sure, but I'm just telling my intuition. The sum of the squares of the from the mean. It's always minimum. The sum of the squares of the deviations from the mean is always minimum. So.
No. Anyway, no problem. See, I don't mind. You keep on trying. Okay, your answer can be wrong. But let us develop a way of interaction, because only when you answer, you know whether the answer is right or wrong. and whether you have understood it. Okay, and you are a student. Nobody should feel embarrassed if the answer is wrong. Okay, if you know the answer, then why you need not be a student, right? So many times you know, but if some, I mean, you know and you can express. Sometimes you know you cannot express. Doesn't matter. If you keep on interacting, then gradually you will have, you know, improve yourself in communication and also, you know, giving the correct answer. Still, I'll give another two minutes if one more student will be able to answer this.
Sir, yeah. Sir, yeah. There are sometimes these deviations can be negative. By scoring, we can get rid of these deviations, so that we will get a much more accurate measure of these deviations just by summation.
Again, you know, that is not coming clear. I mean, you understand, I know, but you know, it has to come in order. Okay, let me do it now. Say in this example, okay, assume we have deviations like 1 plus 2 plus 1 minus 2, okay, say again plus 1, okay. So if I add up, what is my sum here? My sum is 4. I need to 5. No, I have, how many I have? 5. Yeah, so here 4, 5 minus 2, so 3. The sum is 3, right? Another example could be, I have 10 plus 20 minus 5 minus 20 plus 5. So let me make this plus 5 also. Okay. So here, what is the sum? Sum is 0. Okay. Now, when we are talking about deviation, the deviation stands for bigger error, isn't it? Deviation stands for bigger error. Lesser the deviation, it is better, right? So deviation, if deviation is higher, what does it mean? The estimated value is far from the actual value. It is a bad thing. It is a penalty. Okay. If deviation is lesser, it appears your estimated value is very close to your actual value. So it is a good thing. It is more precision. Okay. Now assume this is the first sum, say sum of DI1. Assume this is DI1. And say this is sum of DI2 in this case. So here it appears, if I compare this sum of these deviations, it appears 3 is bad, 0 is good. Isn't it? It appears like this. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
As a whole, it appears, say this is line 2 and this is line 1. So it appears line 2 is a better fit than line 1. Line 2 explains the pattern of relation between YI and XI in a better way compared to line 1. It appears because this sum is hiding something. The sum is basically hiding actual deviations. You look at the deviations, individual deviations in line 2, they are quite huge. 20, minus 20. So too far from the actual values. On the contrary, the maximum deviation of points as per line 1, estimated and actual deviation is within plus minus 2. So here the deviation is ranged in between, say, minus 2 plus 2, within a narrow range. And here deviations are much bigger, minus 20 plus 20, isn't it? So definitely, if you look at the individual deviations, line 2 is not better. Line 1 is better. Okay? So this wrong conclusion, erroneously choosing line 2 as a better fit, looking at 0 compared to 3, can be erroneous if we are ignoring these individual differences of individual points. Okay? So to avoid this, to get rid of this erroneous thing, one way somebody said is we can take square. If we are taking square, square of 1 will be 1, square of 2 will be 4, square of 1 will be 1, square of minus 2 will be 4, square of 1 will be 1. So everything is positive. So you have 8 plus 3, 11 here. Here square of 10 is 100, square of 20 is 400, square of 5 is 25, square of minus 20 is again 400, square of 5 is 25. It's such a huge number you are getting. 400, 400, 800, 950. Right? So if I take square, then these positive deviations and negative deviations, which were canceling in the earlier method, okay, and then making the sum smaller, no more will face that problem because all squares are positive. This is one advantage. I think somebody was telling, but I think she was not clear on this, but I got the point. This is one advantage. When everything is positive, you can better way compare this sum. What is the second advantage? Second advantage is if I'm taking square, the larger deviations are penalized more compared to the smaller deviations. See, 5 square becomes 25, but 20 square becomes 400, right? So between difference between 20 and 5 is just 15. Difference between 400 and 25 is 375. Getting my point? So when you are taking square, then larger deviations are penalized more compared to smaller deviations. So deviation is a bad thing, right? Deviation is error. Less deviation is more precision. So by penalizing larger deviations by a larger amount, our method becomes better, okay, to choose a line which represents lesser deviations from the actual values compared to another line which represents larger deviations. Is it clear as of now? Is it clear, or you know, you require further clarification on this?
Yes, sir, it's clear, sir.
Clear. Okay. Yeah,
sir. If making all these data positive is your ultimate goal, so why cannot we take the mode of hybrid data?
You can do that. So by doing that, first objective, the first advantage you will get, like all are positive, so you are getting the first advantage. Okay, but second advantage you will not get, because in second, what is the second advantage? Second advantage is you are penalizing larger deviation by a larger amount if you are taking square. Okay.
Sorry, sir.
So that second advantage you will not get in taking only absolute value. Okay. Yeah. So that's how I think the better procedure will be taking sum of square of DIs, where I is running from 1 to 5 here in this case. And if you have n individuals, this is 1 to n. Okay. So one procedure, this least square procedure, why we are choosing, we are clear. We are trying to take sum of deviations of actual values from the fitted values, considering line 1, similarly considering line 2, considering line 3, considering line 4, like that, so on and so forth. And we'll choose all lines, and for that particular line for which this sum of squares of deviation. See here, three things are there. Sum of squares of deviations. Deviations is DI. Deviation is basically actual value from estimated value. That deviation, okay, that difference. Then squares, make it square and take sum I running from 1 to n. This is basically my sum of squares, right? So by minimizing sum of squares, applying the principle of minimization of sum of squares, we'll able to fit the best possible line. Now, we will encounter one difficulty. The difficulty is, imagine you can possibly have infinite lines trying to explain the relation between yi and side, infinite number of lines. So shall we calculate sum of di square for line 1, line 2, line 3, line 4, line 100, line 101, line 102, line 1000, line 1 lakh, 1 crore up to infinite, and then see which one is minimum? Is it possible to do? Is it possible to do? Students?
No, sir.
Can I keep? It is practically not possible, because infinite line, you keep on counting and there will be no end of counting. Okay. So there is no end of calculating di square for different lines. So then what we'll do? We cannot apply this procedure, or we have some other way?
Sir, we have to check whether the estimators are blue or not.
Come on. These are bookish answers. You are not understanding my question. My question is, we are trying to find that particular line for which the sum of square of deviation is minimum. Now, it is not practically possible for me to calculate that sum for each line, like, you know, the infinite. See, if it is five lines, assume it is five line, I'll calculate for, say, line one, say that line one sum of square is maybe 25, line two, maybe 36, line four, maybe nine, line five, maybe say 21, another maybe 29. So if five lines are there, I can calculate for each line, and I found that for line three, it is minimum. So I can say line three is best. So that way, beta 0, 3, beta 1, 3 will be the estimated values for our econometric model. Okay. But when there are infinite lines, I keep on counting and it doesn't end. So then, how to know which one, which line gives me minimum sum of squares of deviations? Any answers?
Sir,
you always tell who is talking, because I'm not able to see. What's your name?
Sir, Pragyan.
Pragyan, tell me.
Yes, sir. Sir, if we see that we are closer to the average or the mean value, then we can know that our deviation is less, our error will be less, and we are.
You have not understood, Pragyan, what I'm telling. Okay. See, what I'm telling is, we are trying to fit different lines to explain the relation between yi and xi. Basically, you know, let me go back to the previous graph. Here I have line one and line two. Okay. So when I have two lines or five lines, I can calculate summation di square for each line and then say which one is minimum. And I will say that that is the best line which explains the relation between yi and xi. Isn't it? That is what is your minimizing sum of squares principle is telling, least square principle is telling, correct?
Yes, yes.
My question is, when you have 5, when you have 10, when you have 100 lines, such lines, you can count it for 500, etc., and see which one is minimum. But in reality, there are infinite lines possible to explain the relation between yi and xi. Now, when there are infinite line possible, it is endless for me to count these numbers and find sum of squares for each line, and I will not able to complete this counting and find which one is minimum. Are you getting? All of you are getting my question?
Yes, yes.
But then what is the solution for me? What is the solution for me? Akhilashan?
Yes, sir. I don't know, sir. No idea.
No, all of you know. Actually, when I ask question, generally it is generally common sense question. Dev is there? Rajnish Dev? Rajnish, are you there? Not there today. Who else? Abhirami?
Yes, sir. But, sir, I don't know exactly, but is it like through the graphical method where we plot the points and we look at which one is like? more because
no, again I think you didn't get my question. You know, no problem. You know, the econometrics is something, no, I want you to understand fully. Okay, so if Abhirami didn't understand this my question, then many of you are not understanding. Okay, let me do it again. Okay, so I can keep this and add a new. Yeah, see, my question is this. See, you had this graph where you have many scattered points, okay, depicting the relation between yi and xi. Okay, I can possibly think of line one, say this is line one, and for line one I can calculate this error sum of squares. So let me put it as error sum of squares, ESS 1, by applying that procedure, applying this formula, applying summation di 1 I running from 1 to 10, whatever points are there. So say I calculated this to be, say, 20. Possible? For line 1, maybe this value is 20. This value, ESS, is 20. For line 2, assume this is line 2. Similarly, I'll have line for line 2, ESS 2, maybe 11. I may have line 3 and ESS 3 is 14, maybe. Similarly, ESS 4 can be 21. ESS 5 can be 8. Right? So in case I have only 5 possible lines which can explain this relation, what I can do, I'm telling, for each line I'll calculate this value like this: 20, 11, 14, 21, 8. And among them, which was the minimum? This is minimum. So this is minimum means this is suggesting there is large precision in my estimation. There is a largest precision in that particular line explaining the relation between yn and xi. Yi and xi. Okay, so what I'm telling, if I have 5 such lines, or 10 such lines, or 21 such lines, or 100 such lines, I can calculate ESS 1, ESS 2, ESS 3, etc., and compare between them and find which one is minimum. Correct? All of you understood until now? Abhirami, did you understand this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, my problem is what I'm telling. In reality, there are infinite lines possible. So ESS 1, ESS 2, ESS 3, ESS 4, ESS 5, ESS 1 lakh, ESS 1 lakh 1, ESS 1 crore, and up to infinite. So that means I will not end up calculating these numbers which I'm referring here, these numbers I will not complete to calculate, because there are infinite lines possible to explain the relation between yi and xi, isn't it? Then how I'll end up estimating beta 1, beta 2, which are best? Sorry, beta 0 and beta 1, which are best for me? That is the question. So for that, what we'll do? You know, the answer is
sir,
very
can simple. Can you take the slope of the lines?
Where slope of line is coming? I mean, the good that you are trying to give answer. Where slope of the line is coming? See, each once I choose, this is my best line, this will give me beta 0, 5 and beta 1, 5. No, it's automatically giving me. Once I'm choosing ESS 5 as the best, lowest, so that line, line number 5, is the best. So I get a slope which is the best corresponding to that line. Okay. The point is, how I end up choosing 5 or 4 or 100 or 1 lakh or what number is that when there are infinite lines, because I cannot stop counting. I'll not able to stop counting, right? See, the answer is very simple. You have learnt about calculus. Yes or no? In calculus, you know how to find a minimum, maximum, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Sir, we have to minimize the error.
Yeah, that is what we're doing. It's not minimize error. You are minimizing the sum of square of error, not minimizing error, right?
Yes.
Your sum of square of errors are this, no? This is sum of squares of errors. That is what I said, ESS, error sum of squares. This is sum of squares errors when line is 1. This is sum of square of errors when line is 2. This is line is 3. This line is 4. This line is 5. So this is, among them, this is minimum. So to find minimum, you need not count this sum of square for each of the infinite lines. We can apply the principle of calculus, minimization principle, which we learnt in calculus. That's how mathematics is handy with us. When you are not able to handle certain things like counting infinite lines, then I can use calculus and apply the minimization principle. Okay, so the mathematics which I will be using is my sum of square errors, okay, which is di, and in our model it is ui, right? Di, what I explained in the graph, in our model it is ui, right? So this is the sum of squares of errors. Yes, here ui is di, what I explained earlier. Now this need to be minimized, okay? This need to minimize subject to what? Subject to choosing beta 0, subject to choosing beta 1. So you know the first order and second order condition for minimization. So I will take partial derivative of this with respect to beta 0, set it equal to 0. Similarly, I will take partial derivative of ui square with respect to beta 1 and set it equal to 0. And if you see, the second order condition will be automatically satisfied. You have learned these things in mathematics in our module 4, right? No, module 5. On constant maximization, minimization. So these are the first order conditions, and automatically you will see that second order conditions also meeting here. Now, once I set this, see your ui is what? You look at your model, your yi is equal to beta 0 plus beta 1 xi plus ui, isn't it? So from here I can get ui is equal to yi minus beta 0 minus beta 1 xi, okay? Then square of this means square of this, summation of this means summation of this, right? So you take 0, you find what is it. This I'll give you as homework, okay? Similarly, you take partial derivative with respect to beta 1, okay? You see what is that, okay? And from there, you will get these normal equations. Where I have the normal equation here. Now from the first equation, first setting summation, ui square with respect to beta 0 is equal to 0, you will get this equation. And from the second one with respect to beta 1, you will get this equation. Okay, now you have two equations and two unknowns. See, summations ci you know, because ci values you have, yi values you have, so you have summation yi also. So what you n is number of observation here, okay? 5 or 10 or 100, that is number of observations. So n also you know. What you don't know beta 0, you don't know beta 1. Similarly here, beta 0, u and beta 1. Other than that, you know everything. So you have two equations in two unknowns. Now if you solve those two equations in two unknowns, you will find this. You will find beta 1 is mean of c minus beta 1 mean of. See, here's C star. See, in this model, I think C is my dependent variable, Y is my explanatory variable. So here, dependent variable Y is C, independent variable X is Y. So that's how these are the notations. Okay. So from here, if you solve these equations, I'll find beta, I'm sorry, this is beta 0, type error. This is beta 0. Beta 0 is mean of C. Okay, what I'll do, I will have these formulas in general notation, because you know this will again get confused with C and Y. So I will replace this, discard, and have this in the general form which we are having. So this is beta zero, make this correction. Of course, these formulas are there in your Gujarati or any book. Your beta zero is mean of dependent variable minus beta one hat. This is estimated, which we are estimating, beta one hat x bar. After you solve this two equations in two unknowns, one you will find with value of beta zero hat is mean of y minus beta one hat mean of x, and you will find beta one hat is equal to n summation yi xi minus summation yi summation xi whole over n summation yi square minus summation yi whole square. Okay, see, all of you remember these formulas, right? In examination there could be some examples will be given to calculate values of beta zero hat, beta one hat, given values of yi and xi. So these two formulas you mug up. Okay, so anytime I can ask, you should able to tell me. This is very simple, actually. You know, once we apply logic, these formulas are very simple. Okay, so this way, by applying minimization principle, which we learnt in calculus, you can calculate values of beta zero hat, beta one hat, which are basically some sort of application of OLS procedure, ordinary least square procedure. Why it is called ordinary least square? Later on, we'll be discussing about WLS, GLS, which are some advanced version of this OLS. Ordinary least square is the basic one, and later on we'll have some estimation procedures which are improved upon this. That's why, you know, there are many least square procedures. There are one class of least square procedure, and within that class, OLS is the first basic procedure which you are learning. So applying OLS procedure, applying the minimization of sum of squares of deviations, and you know, through the calculus formulas, setting partial derivative, first order partial derivative equal to zero, we got these normal equations. From these normal equations, you are getting beta zero hat and beta one hat. And if some of you, please don't get confused. My ci here is yi, and my yi here is xi here. Okay. So remember this. And then I think next of the things we'll be discussing in this class. Now, if you have any doubts, please ask me. I'll take attendance now. I'll take attendance now. So in the meantime, you think of if you have any questions. I'll stop the recording also.